If you think you already know how the story of Ice and Fire ends, guess again, because the winds of winter are blowing.
Sir Kevin tried to rise, but the strength had left him. He could not feel his legs. I thought the crossbow fitting. You shared so much with Lord Tywin. Why not that? Your niece will think the Tyrells had you murdered, mayhaps with the connivance of the imp. The Tyrells will suspect her. Someone somewhere will find a way to blame the Dornishmen. Doubt, division, and mistrust will eat the very ground beneath your boy king, whilst Aegon raises his banner above Storm's End, and the lords of the realm gather round him. Aegon. For a moment he did not understand, then he remembered. A babe swaddled in a crimson cloak, the cloth stained with his blood and brains. Dead. He's dead. No. The eunuch's voice seemed deeper. He is here. Aegon has been shaped for rule since before he could walk. He has been trained in arms, as befits a knight to be. But that was not the end of his education. He reads and writes. He speaks several tongues. He has studied history and law and poetry. A scepter has instructed him in the mysteries of the faith since he was old enough to understand them. He has lived with fisher folk, worked with his hands, swum in rivers, and mended nets, and learned to wash his own clothes at need. He can fish and cook and bind up a wound. He knows what it is like to be hungry, to be hunted, to be afraid. Tommen has been taught that kingship is his right. Aegon knows that kingship is his duty, that a king must put his people first and live and rule for them.
All right, so that quote is super awesome. And we can see from that quote that Varys is interested in sowing chaos, and he's totally willing to murder and cause all of this stuff to happen to keep Cersei in power, because he knows that she'll be easy to take down because he wants Aegon on the throne. He feels like Aegon is the best potential ruler of Westeros, and he's willing to do what it takes to make it happen. And it's justify the means for Varys, it seems like.
Yeah, the gore in this scene is tremendous. Maester Pycelle's laying in a pool of brains and blood. The children come in their hands, the daggers. It's creepy. It's definitely a nice horror turn. Even the raven on the windowsill and the snowball moon, it's all very creepy. But I am here in my most ridiculous Golden Company dragon outfit because I love Fagon. My name is Fagon, and I'm just pumped for this episode. Here it is. This is your time. Whether you think Trugon or Fagon, he is going to be a big plot line in The Winds of Winter, which was not in the show at all. So this is one of the biggest differences book to show.
Aegon and Jon Connington, they're in Westeros. They're here to claim the throne. Now, the people of Westeros hate Cersei. She does not care about them. They reminisce about the time when the Targaryens ruled. They reminisce about Rhaegar and then even Aerys, because, you know, Aerys was kind of, he's bad to the nobles. The nobles really see the crazy side of him. But when it comes to the common people of Westeros, they're not necessarily seeing that. They just know that all their crops weren't being burned and they weren't having to go through endless wars when the Targaryens were ruling. So yeah, they reminisce about a time when the Targaryens ruled.
Sorry, I was just jumping in to say, they remember King Jaehaerys and Queen Alysanne too in the King's Road. And there's a lot of things that the Targaryens have done outside of the madness of Aerys.
Yeah, things have been chaotic since, you know, Robert Baratheon took the throne. Things haven't been necessarily thriving. So Fagon is handsome and young and male and Targaryen. And if he was truly a legit Targaryen, his claim to the throne would surpass Dany's, because he'd be the son of Prince Rhaegar.
Rhaegar, beautiful Rhaegar. Yes, so that's specifically who he reminds people of. And he's trying to coast on the back of that Rhaegar brand, for sure. He'll be doing that hard.
But the thing is, he has time to establish himself in Westeros before Dany gets there. So he will threaten her claim to the throne, and there's a few potential directions that could go in.
So our first question is, who do you think you are, sir? Who do we think he is? We didn't have time to do the whole Blackfyre theory, but I think we're both agreed that he's almost certainly a Blackfyre, that the whole thing about the Blackfyre dying out of the male line that Illyrio talks about means the female line is alive. Mm-hmm. Fagon is probably Illyrio's son. Yeah, so that's he's a Blackfyre that's going to be passed off as a Targaryen.
Yes, I tend to agree that he is the son of Illyrio's long lost love, who he waxes on poetically about. But yeah, I tend to agree that he's probably a Blackfyre and most likely Illyrio's son. I don't know if he necessarily knows exactly who he is, but I think he has probably some questions. I don't think he necessarily buys the story that he's being told.
I do think they probably have lied to him, though. Like, when he tells Tyrion who he is, it seems like he believes it. He might doubt it, but that seems like that's what he's been told, as opposed to he's telling a story to Tyrion. But it is a little bit unclear, so we'll see.
Why would they tell him the truth? Like, the best way to do it would be to convince him that he was that person, because then he wouldn't be lying. It would be natural to him.
Yeah, well, I guess then you risk having, you know, him being exposed and having some sort of breakdown later. You might sit him down at age 14, like, listen, it's time to have a talk, son, you know. But probably you're right. Yeah, exactly. Your whole life is a lie. Probably you are correct that the best way he can fake it is for him to think it's real. So,
and then, of course, one of the big questions is, will Aegon take the throne before Dany returns to Westeros? And the answer I think that we both agree on is almost certainly yes. Because he is the Mummer's Dragon, cheered amongst the crowd from the Vision. He's being cheered by the crowd, so that means that he's going to take down Cersei and be cheered by the people of King's Landing and Westeros for it.
Yeah, and let's take apart that whole Mummer's Dragon, what it means. So the actual Vision says a cloth dragon swayed on poles amidst the cheering crowd. And then Dany later explains that a cloth dragon on poles is called a Mummer's Dragon. She says Mummers use them in their follies to give the heroes something to fight. So that is like the big giveaway here. Fagon is controlled by literal mummers, Varys and Illyrio, and he's there to give the hero someone to fight. So probably he's there to play the heel, if you will.
And then, of course, we have Cersei, who is weak and paranoid and delusional and growing gradually more and more delusional as the days goes on. She's surrounded by enemies, a lot of which she creates herself because of her paranoia and her delusions. And Varys wants her in power because he recognizes these things about Cersei. He recognizes that she's kind of chaos and wildfire, and she's best. King's Landing is prime for the taking because of Cersei.
I was going to say Cersei's increasing paranoia and also increasing drinky. And you wonder if Varys is like making sure that she's always got the best wine, much in the way that Lancel fed King Robert the strong wine.
And you know, the thing about Cersei too is that typically she's always tempered by some other power. Like it was Robert there, and then, you know, maybe Tyrion there, and then later she still had Jaime, and then even after that she had the Tyrells having certain influence because of being married in. Now it's Cersei on top of the world, and there's nothing to temper it. So it's, yeah.
Cersei is unchained to fly free and soar like the eagle. Yes, it's gonna be great. Yes. So the Sage is dead. And we should also point out the pure timeline issues. Dany, at the end of Dance with Dragons, is in the Dothraki Sea, about to begin a whole new confrontation with the Dothraki, which will probably take her to the womb of the world and back to Meereen before she can strike the deal with the Ironborn and sail back to Westeros. That's a lot of time. It might not even, it'll just be happening by the end of the next book. Fagon's going to be in King's Landing halfway through the next book. So there's a lot of time gap in between those two.
And, you know, like I said, just as Cersei has all these enemies, Fagon has friends in King's Landing. Varys, like I mentioned, is one of the key friends in Westeros, in King's Landing specifically. He's lived in King's Landing. He knows the secrets of the city. He's one of the best friends to have in that city.
Right. So, he's got a lot of allies and debts that he can call and little birds and all that stuff. And then there's the Dornish. Depending on how things go with Arion and Fagon, which we'll find out very soon in the Winds of Winter, the Dornish could be on Team Fagon. I can't remember if it was Tyene or Lady Nym, but one of them was sent to King's Landing to make trouble or be ready to make trouble. So I mean, that's what Dornish do, is make trouble. So there's a couple wild cards that could happen there. And then, of course, there's the extra factor of Quentin and what happened to him.
Yeah, so if they realize what happened to Quentin, meaning that he was roasted by one of Dany's dragons, that would, I think, kind of push them on Team Aegon over Dany, because, you know, what really happened doesn't necessarily matter. All they would know would be he was killed by one of Dany's dragons. So did she kill him? Did she? Well, you know, I think they would assume that she had something to do with it. So it wouldn't be good for Dany either way.
Yeah, in the world of A Song of Ice and Fire, that seems like the perfect thing to be misunderstood and misreported. So we'll see. Mm-hmm.
Especially with all the rumors already about Dany, you know, feeding people to her dragons and doing all these crazy things.
Yeah, we saw some of those in our Volantis episode. But next question, how will Jon Con screw things up? Because inevitably he will. He has Grayscale. He's got a limited time. It's making him hasty. He's in a hurry. And Grayscale can cause madness too.
He'll make some crazier decisions probably. You mentioned the point that the Battle of the Bells is weighing on him, and that was when he wasn't ruthless enough. He wasn't enough like Tywin, and it caused them to lose. So maybe because of the Grayscale making him crazier, and because of, you know, that regret, he'll be more willing to do something insane, like potentially light King's Landing on fire.
Yeah, or burn a bunch of people in the Sept of Baelor. I could see the Sept of Baelor being Jon Con's fault, but Cersei mm-hmm. getting blamed or something like that. You know, some of the foreshadowing, Quinn, in A Song of Ice and Fire is very cryptic. Waves mm-hmm. of night and blood, symbolic language, things like that. Mm-hmm. Then there's foreshadowing like Jon Con repeatedly stewing on, I wasn't enough like Tywin. I wasn't enough like Tywin. Really should have burned all those people in those village. Just if I get another chance, I'll definitely not, you know, screw that up again. Like, mm-hmm. you can see where this is going, and it's a dark place.
And there's also the fact that Grayscale is highly contagious, right? Mm. Just that in general. He could potentially... I mean, if someone has Grayscale and they put them like on an island somewhere away from the rest of civilization. So they take it super seriously. And above the wall, they don't even play it. They just kill you immediately, right? You had Craster, who was kind of going against that by keeping his daughters in the shed. But then he eventually did decide to kind of put them out of their misery anyway. But yeah, so it's
Jon Con, like, I'll go to King's Landing.
Yeah.
With my diseases and stuff.
This highly populated city where there's a lot of trade going on. And like, this is the center of, you know, Westeros, basically.
What could go wrong? So yeah, that's just what King's Landing and Westeros needs, right? Is a good Grayscale epidemic just to set things up for the others. And probably going to happen.
Yeah. So in the TV show, we see the scene where Dany hears the bells and goes crazy for no reason. It's more likely that this relates to Jon Connington. Rather than Dany, don't you think?
Battle of the Bells. I mean, the bells ringing literally traumatized him. He was being traumatized as the bells were pounding his defeat. So yes, if this was something they got from George, then probably it's going to involve Jon Con and not Dany, who associates bells with victory because the Dothraki put bells in their hair for victory. So,
it doesn't make sense for Dany. It makes sense for the character Jon Con because of the reasons that you just mentioned. It relates to his backstory, and there's nothing for Dany that does that with bells. Yeah.
So, and there you have it. So next question, how will the Westerosi react to Fagon?
So we touched on this a little bit earlier. They'll obviously be receptive. They remember the times when the Targaryens ruled. It was the best times they'd had. I mean, times have not been good since Robert Baratheon stepped on the Iron Throne, really. Things have kind of been on a decline. So they reminisce about the time when the Targaryens ruled. They hate Cersei. So if he comes down, takes down House Lannister, then I think they'll accept him.
Yeah, I think the Cloth Dragon cheering crowd thing is pretty straightforward. It means just what it sounds like. You can picture literally Fagon riding into King's Landing in it with a parade and everyone's cheering. And maybe they'll have a literal cloth dragon like Targaryen sigil just because George likes to stack up the humor. But you get the idea. The parade is coming, that triumphant moment. We're going to feel very cheated because we're like, this should have been Dany's moment. And Fagon's going to be soaking it all up. And, you know, we read in that opening quote, Varys is going on and on about how well-trained Fagon is and, oh, he's done this and he's fished and he's lived this way and he knows what it's like and blah, blah, blah. He's a perfect king. Thing is, there are some flies in the ointment. And there's a great scene with Tyrion and Fagon on the Roine when they're playing chess. And it shows you a bit of Fagon's personality as well as a couple other things. So perhaps I overstated. She may take pity on you when you come begging for her hand. The dwarf shrugged. Do you want to wager your throne upon a woman's whim? Go to Westeros, though. Ah, then you're a rebel, not a beggar. Bold, reckless, a true scion of House Targaryen, walking in the footsteps of Aegon the Conqueror, a dragon. I told you, I know our little queen. Let her hear that her brother Rhaegar's murdered son is still alive, that this brave boy has raised his dragon standard of her forebears in Westeros once more, that he is fighting a desperate war to avenge his father and reclaim the Iron Throne for House Targaryen, hard-pressed on every side. She will fly to your side as fast as wind and water can carry her. You are the last of her line, and this mother of dragons, this breaker of chains, is above all a rescuer. The girl who drowned the slave cities in blood rather than leave strangers to their chains can scarcely abandon her own brother's son in this hour of peril. And when she reaches Westeros and meets you for the first time, you'll meet as equals, man and woman, not queen and supplicant. How can she help but love you then, I ask? Smiling, he seized his dragon, flew it across the board. I hope your grace will pardon me. Your king is trapped, death in four. The prince stared at the playing board. My dragon is too far away to save you. You should have moved her to the center of the battle. But you said, I lied. Trust no one and keep your dragons close. Young Griff jerked to his feet and kicked over the board. Syvas pieces flew in all directions, bouncing and rolling across the deck of the Shy Maid. Pick those up, the boy commanded. He may well be a Targaryen after all. If it pleases your grace. Tyrion got down on his hands and knees and began to crawl about the deck, gathering up pieces.
Yeah, so there's that underlying, almost like Joffrey-esque anger, childish anger and rage, right? So it's like, if I can't win, then I'm just going to knock the whole board over, right? Maybe that's a little bit of foreshadowing for more, what Aegon might do in the future.
I think that's like right on the nose there, actually, because how many metaphors are there for the whole Syvas pieces with the Tyrion stuff that we talked about? Mm-hmm. It's constantly a metaphor for the game of war. Tyrion talks about it in this chapter, how, you know, young Griff and Aegon are just pieces that Illyrio's moving around. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, if he can't have his way, he's going to flip over the board. That sounds like blowing some shit up, doesn't it?
Yeah, really messing everybody else up. Yeah.
Yeah, and the Syvas dragon is foreshadowing too. Tyrion picks up the black dragon, flies it over, which is Drogon, and mm-hmm. kills him with it. And it's like, mm-hmm. yeah, you should have kept your dragons close, because he had just given him all this advice about how Dany's going to love him. And then he's like, psych! Dragon could kill you also, by the way. So that's...
Yeah. But like I said to you earlier, Dany is also probably tired of marriage proposals. And Fagon has this idea in his head that, like, I'm going to get to Westeros and win all this, and she'll love me. But no, she's like, I have my own ambitions and they don't include you, Fagon. This is my throne. I've got the dragons. F off.
Yeah, and so Tyrion's listening to the Red Priest and Volantis and noticing that they're only talking about one hero with dragons. And he's thinking to himself, you know, young Griff was thinking to use the Red Priest to help Fagon. Like, that doesn't sound like a good plan. They're only talking about one hero, not two. So there's a lot of foreshadowing of conflict here, not only conflict between Dany and Fagon, but just conflict of the whole Fagon Jon Con plan going wrong at some point. So just because he's going to be the Mummer's dragon doesn't mean they won't like screw up royally or sow the seeds for their own downfall, you know. So, but yeah, this is getting right into how Dany will react to Fagon, which is our next big question. How will Dany react to them? So there's Tyrion's take on it, right?
Yeah. Which is, you know, kind of, you know, obviously not the way it's going to go down. That's the way Fagon wished it would go down. But, you know, Dany, she'll realize that with Fagon there, that she is kind of redundant. And I don't think she'll like that with everything that she's been through so far. And she'll definitely have Quaid's prophecy in mind, the mm-hmm. Mummer's dragon. So she might be, he might be suspect to her. Like, are you a real Targaryen?
Right. Not only the Mummer's dragon, but she'll probably have Tyrion as an advisor, Hand of the Dragon, at some point. And Tyrion definitely suspects that Fagon is fake. And mm-hmm. this is another great, I just love these Fagon quotes. They're the best. So say what you want. She will be my bride. Lord Connington will see to it. I trust him as much as if he were my own blood. Perhaps you should be the fool instead of me. Trust no one, my prince, not your chainless maester, not your false father, nor the gallant duck, nor the lovely Lamor, nor these other fine friends who grew you from a bean. Above all, trust not the cheesemonger, nor the spider, nor this little dragon queen you mean to marry. All that mistrust will sour your stomach and keep you awake by night, 'tis true, but better that than the long sleep that does not end. The dwarf pushed his black dragon across a range of mountains. But what do I know? Your false father is a great lord, and I am just a twisted little monkey man. Still, I do things differently. And so that was right before the last bit where he suggested what to do. But Yeah, grew you from a bean. That means like this is all a little too perfect, this story, right?
Yeah, he's implying that you are their creation.
Whole identity is like just a fake ID and all of that.
Your life is a lie.
Yeah. So yeah, and the whole point again is that between the Mummer's Dragon bit and Tyrion's advice, Dany will probably figure out that he's fake. I do think that the idea of family will appeal to Dany, and it will foreshadow how she'll feel about Jon finding out when he's a Targaryen later. However, I think what you're going to have is Dany having some sort of conflict about, oh, maybe he's real, and eventually deciding he's not. Maybe even like after he dies, she won't be sure about it. Hard to say. It's all kinds of heart-rending stuff that George can write.
Here's the deal. Fagon is going to get eaten by Drogon. I've always felt like that was going to happen. He's going to get eaten. Yep. Somebody's got to get like just eaten up by the dragon at Dany's command, and it's going to be him.
Well, so shout out to Baal the Bard of the Dragon's Reign YouTube channel, who's just starting a whole series about the Dance of the Dragons and the parallels to the endgame of the Song of Ice and Fire. But Rhaenyra, who is like sort of a half-year queen, she gets eaten by a dragon, and it is her brother's dragon. So the idea of Fagon getting eaten by Dany's dragon and they're, you know, supposedly related could be an interesting parallel. Yeah, that could happen.
I imagine that Dany could potentially use the dragons as a test, and she could just be like, come pet Drogon, come pet him. And then Drogon's like, nope, not letting you pet me, dude. Munch, and everybody sees it.
The survey says you are not the father.
That's not the son.
Exactly. Yeah, you are not the son. Yes, that is kind of where we see this going. A lot of tragedy in the Fagon plotline, just to sort of put a button on this thing. There's going to be some tragedy on the way to King's Landing. The Dornish are hanging around. They're very good at tragedy.
Yeah.
And we've got lots of things ready to blow up in King's Landing. We've got lots of crazy people like Jon Con and Cersei. And even Varys, you could make the argument, like his level of utilitarianism can go pretty damn far. False flags. And then finally, the idea of a Dance of the Dragons redux with Dany and Fagon. So it's going to be a big mess, essentially.
It's going to be an exciting mess.
The spider's mess.
Webs, like you said, are all over this, and we don't know exactly how far they reach.
Yeah, I think the King's Landing is probably going to suffer a series of casualties. Maybe some grayscale, too. There might not be anything left by the time.
I thought you were going to say a series of unfortunate events. But okay.
Oh, very unfortunate. Yeah, let me think it totally. Very more disastrous events.
Yeah.
Thanks for watching, everyone. I'm LML. That was Quinn.
I'm Quinn. Make sure you like and subscribe to both of our channels. Links in the description. Peace, guys.
See you next time.